Welcome to this lecture series on balances as guides towards a sustainable future. My name is Andreas Pfennig and I am coming from the Institute of Chemical Engineering and Environmental Technology of the TU Graz in Austria. With this series of short lectures, I would like to introduce you to how balances can be applied to global processes and especially those that are induced by man. That is, how do we use our resources? How do we use energy? How do we produce food? And how does all that relate? Possibly also with climate, with land area, things like that. Well, I'm a chemical engineer. And why am I, as a chemical engineer, thinking that I can say anything relevant about that? But the point is that in order to set up, to design processes in chemical industry, for example, as a chemical engineer, what we are very often using are balances. Balances that tell us that what is entering also has to leave a certain process. We have to account for the changes of the properties, of the composition of the different things entering and leaving such a process. And that in the end leads to the quantitative design of such a process. That is, whenever a new product is desired, we design a new process and we also design the apparatus which is required to run the process. For that we are using balances. Now, since these balances tell us so much about how things work, how things interact, it might be interesting to apply these balances also to what the humans are doing to the global environment, to the global resources, and how the human process, so to speak, those big processes that the humans are running on this earth, how they interrelate and how they can be described by balances. And the question is, can we learn something from that? I can say, yes, we can learn a lot of that. That's why I'm giving this presentation, and that's also why I think as a chemical engineer that I have something to say on these balances on the global scale. Well, I will lead you to through a series of such presentations. How are they organized? Well, in the first part, I will give you some motivation, some background, so to speak. What are the topics in general we will be talking about? Then I will introduce the concept of balances. How do they work? How are they applied? And I will apply it explicitly on the radiation equilibrium, balances of this equilibrium, or radiation on the Earth, sunlight coming in and radiation to, well, the universe, so to speak, of the Earth. What does that mean? And we will talk a little bit how balances are set up and how you solve them. If you think that you know already everything about balances, you can skip that chapter if you like. In the next step, I would like to look a little bit at where we are today. What are our resources? What do we know how we are using them? And this is then the basis to go to the next step, that is, where do we go in the future? There I want to look at various scenarios, discuss them a little bit, and would like to focus on four subtopics. One topic is the fossil energy carriers, the world population, and the standard of living. Of course, now we don't understand how these three things interrelate, but when we are there, I think we will realize in the end. The next topic that's obviously more fitting together, it's atmosphere, carbon dioxide, and climate. How do they interrelate? Then land area, bioenergy, and nutrition, apparently also something that is related with each other. And then finally, the options for a sustainable energy supply. Which options do we have? Then, of course, we wind up with what we should do with that, the conclusion, so to speak. On the one hand side, what does this mean for us? Can we deduce something, how we should behave, for example? And finally, or what we should do, what we should develop, what we should enforce? And finally, I would like to make some very final few conclusions. Now, this is apparently a rather big topic, so I've split the entire presentation into separate videos of half an hour roughly length, sometimes some a little bit shorter, some a little bit longer, And I will take my time to go through each topic in a, I think, moderate pace. Today, let me start with the motivation. And for me, the motivation actually was this article. I may not reproduce that because of copyright regulations, but nevertheless, I give the title. The title was, "The Farmer of Today Will Be the Oil Sheikh of Tomorrow." It was published in September 2006 in a local newspaper, and I read this article, and especially the subtitle tells a little bit what the idea of this article was about. In future, electricity and heat are produced on farmland. All that can be produced from crude oil plants can, all that can be produced from crude oil, plants can supply as well. Only politics has to rethink. This was part of a series published by Franz Alt in various newspapers, apparently. Franz Alt is a very famous journalist in Germany who is very often tackling problems of sustainability about, well, bioenergy, biomass utilization, about how solar energy is used, how wind energy is used. That are his topics he's writing about. Well, at first sight, if you read this, it sounds nice. Everything that can be produced from crude oil, plants can produce as well. And the end point of this article was, well, if you have plant oil, you can more or less do everything with it that you can also do with crude oil. Now, I should say, I looked at that and I thought, well, yes, of course, as a chemical engineer, I know if you have some substance which is containing energy, you convert it to, you can convert it to many other substances also containing energy, and you can use those things then the same way you would use the crude oil products. No problem. As a chemical engineer, I know you can fiddle around with those things very easily. The question I had when I read that was, well, do the numbers fit? How much plants can I use in order to, well, supply humanity with all the needs they have? We know we need food, we need plants as food, we need, well, crude oil for, as an energy carrier, or products from crude oil as energy carrier. We use crude oil as input to the chemical industry to produce all the plastics and whatever that's around us. Lots of amounts of substance. And the question is, yes, can plants supply this huge amount of matter that we are utilizing in our everyday life with respect to energy or as material? Well, in the end it turned out, I will tell this ahead of time a little bit, it does not really turn out. We will see why and how it does not turn out. In order to figure that out, you need balances. And that's why I used balances for describing that, and then came up with some factual numbers that you can interrelate and may directly see that bioenergy, for example, is not a big option. But that's the final result, and I will explain how we get there. Well, in the following, I will show some slides and comment on them, that they are coming from the rest of the presentations, but they give, so to speak, the frame of the presentation. They show a little bit what the presentation will be about. The first thing you may look at is the crude oil price in euro per barrel, barrel being roughly 60 liters, as a function of time. And you see that from 1980 to almost 2000, or 1985 to almost 2000, the crude oil price remained constant. There were significant fluctuations, yes, but the level more or less was stable. Then after 2000, another 15 years, apparently the behavior changed dramatically. There we observe an increase in crude oil price by annually 12%. Every year, the crude oil price on average has risen by 12%. This is considerable. A considerable amount. Much more than inflation, for example. And you see that, of course, the band which I have presented here is rather wide. From the average value, which is represented by this thick red curve, we see a factor 2 to the top and a factor 2 to the bottom, so half of it and double of it on this logarithmic scale. And we see that the band of this factor 4, so to speak, opens up, of course, as the numbers increase, but we also see that the crude oil price always stays within this band, even in the event of an economic crisis around 2008, or in 2008, we realized that the crude oil price dropped dramatically, but it stayed more or less within this band. Before the crisis, you see on the other hand side that the crude oil price was extremely increasing. This is so steep, this is almost 30% per year that the oil price was increasing. Then hit, so to speak, the upper border, then dropped due to the crisis, but then speed it up again in order to, well, wind up at the average value again. Here's the average value, then a little bit too much, it came down. This is now where we are today. It's somewhere in 2014, and well, it can be expected that it won't drop as much as to hit the lower border in the near future. Well, we don't know. There are crises, as a crisis around in Ukraine, for example, so we don't know how that will influence the situation here. The question you can pose with respect to that slide is, why is the crude oil price increasing? Is that an indication that we are running out of crude oil? Are the resources that we have being depleted? Can we say something about that? So this will be one question to be answered in the following. Next slide I want to show is the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere as a function of time. Again, time scale. The CO2 content in the atmosphere is given in ppmv. What does that mean? Ppm means parts per million. And you see here, in the end, we have 400 parts per million, which is very small, actually. Well, it appears very small. Ppm, parts per million, appears sort of small, but actually it's 400 of that. So it's 0.04%, which is actually a considerable amount in the atmosphere. And the V refers to the fact that this number is given by volume, parts per million, volume-wise. Evaluated. And we see that during the last, well, roughly 50 years, the CO2 concentration has increased from a little bit more than 300 ppmv to almost 400 ppmv. This is a significant increase. And the question is, well, how is this going on? And how does that influence climate? Actually, we don't really know. Now we will discuss that in the following as well. I should say something about the pre-industrial level, which is often referred to. The pre-industrial level, 1850 or so, is around 280 ppm. So since then we have increased by 120 ppm to reach these almost 400 ppm. And if I say this has an effect possibly on climate, we can look at a diagram prepared from data collected by the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, that, so to speak, collect all the knowledge that we have on climate and the change in the climate, mostly introduced by our human activities. What is given here is the greenhouse gas concentration stabilization level in ppm CO2 equivalent. CO2 equivalent means that not only CO2 is regarded, but also other greenhouse gases like methane, for example, and they are somehow converted so as to represent a CO2 equivalent. So since we have today also some methane around, actually the greenhouse gas level should be more than 400 ppm CO2 equivalent, because there's an additional contribution by methane, which was not plotted in the previous slide. And as a function of the greenhouse gas concentration, the equilibrium global mean temperature increase above pre-industrial is plotted. Well, what a long name. It's the global mean temperature. And actually only the difference with respect to the pre-industrial value. So it is assumed that at zero we have the pre-industrial value around 850, and now we ask how much higher is the temperature as a function of the greenhouse gas concentration. Equilibrium refers to the fact that you wait long enough so that all dynamic processes, so to speak, have stabilized and we wind up with a more or less constant time-independent value of temperature. Apparently, CO2 concentration is increasing, so we are not in equilibrium yet. Things are moving, so to speak. And the IPCC collected, well, data from various climate studies and plotted them and showed that the data they obtained for the temperature increase versus greenhouse gas concentration again lay within a certain band. This does not say that there's any probabilistic statement that, for example, the black line is the most probable or so. They only say this was the range in which they found predictions. It doesn't say anything about probability. Reality can lie really outside of that. We don't know. But nevertheless, take these data, this information collected here, as a some sort of realistic estimate what's going to happen. And as we saw, we reached 400 ppm of CO2 today already, which means that we have a greenhouse gas increase, temperature increase by roughly 1.5 degrees centigrade already. So we are here, if we take this black line as representing something that has something to do with reality, then we wind up at 1.5 degrees centigrade above pre-industrial. Actually, we have reached this 400 today, but we have not yet reached this 1.5 degrees centigrade. Climatologists tell us that we today are around 0.75, 3/4 of a degree centigrade above the pre-industrial value. So we are far from this 1.5. So if we would wait, just do nothing, it may be that the temperature increases up to this 1.5 level, another 0.75 degrees centigrade. And the question is, of course, well, if we continue or if we use the fossil energy resources that we have, crude oil, natural gas, and coal, convert that to CO2 that we release into the atmosphere, what does that mean for the CO2 level in the atmosphere, and what does that in turn mean for the temperature? Now, that the temperature is increasing, we can observe already. We know that the glaciers, for example, are retreating more or less worldwide. There are some exceptions, but climatologists also tell us, well, if the climate changes on the globe, then some areas will increase in temperature, and maybe that some others may decrease in temperature. But if you take the average, the overall average temperature is increasing. Well, now, taking the average temperature of something as big as the Earth is not a trivial thing to do, but meteorologists and climatologists tell us that they can do that. And since most of the glaciers are retreating, this is really a strong indication that their statements about climate change, about temperature increase, has something to do with reality, with what we observe in reality. So this is something also related to the balances, apparently. Now, if we have seen before and have discussed something about bioenergy, remember the article written by Franz Alt, which was the starting point for myself. The question is, of course, if I use bioenergy, how does that relate to the nutrition of humanity? We need food. How can that be supplied? And do we have to do something about how we eat and what we eat? And there are, of course, some famous people who rethink their personal living style and become, for example, vegetarian. In this case, Paul McCartney. So what we see here is that there may be some interrelation between living style and the use of resources. And perhaps also balances can tell us something about that. Well, setting up balances And looking at quantitative numbers and how they develop actually has a pretty long history. I have collected some of the publications that we find. In 1798, Malthus wrote an essay on the principle of population. In that essay, he stated already that population increase may be exponential and that the resources may not grow sufficiently quick in order to supply all people with enough food. So he already realized that there may be some problems if population increases exponentially. Then there were some studies, so to speak. Interestingly enough, some were to the President of the United States, and that actually was when all these considerations started to go their way towards politics. Then very famous, Meadows, the Club of Rome, the Limits to Growth, who really started to set up models, quantitative models, based again on balances in order to see how the world with all the human activities will evolve in the future, and how that will develop in the future. World Dynamics then is by Forrester, it's a book which is written about really modeling the world and how to model the dynamics, very detailed model actually. Based on that, these previous things and the Global 2000 report to the president, and then it really arrived in politics, the Brundtland report, Our Common Future. And since then, we have the World Climate Meetings every year, and since then, of course, all this discussion started. Then I have here also a book in German, which is quite interesting. Dörner, Die Logik des Misslingens, Logic of Failure, where he very nicely explains how, and well, actually more why, the human logic fails to intuitively grasp what it means to have exponential growth. If we see that population is growing exponentially, our brain, our perception is not able really to grasp that completely and to see how it relates to other things. And that is why we need models, mathematical models that describe how the interrelations are, balances for example, in order to be able to see the consequences of our doing. And so, this is a very interesting book as well. Then there are some updates to the Meadows, the Club of Rome, the Limits to Growth, Beyond the Limits, where they say that we have passed the limits that we had already, and the 30 years update finally. Well, this is a historical background on which I dwell a little bit. Finally, I would like to state something why I, as an engineer, think that it's wise to look at those things, really as on an engineering perspective. Well, first of all, we want to have quantitative statements. You want to have quantitative statements what you should do and what you should not do, what we as humanity should do, perhaps. As an engineer, I'm used to that. If I design a plant, a chemical plant, for example, that produces something, I want to give quantitative statements directly in the beginning. How big does the process have to be to produce exactly what is desired? How expensive will the process be? You have to know all that concerning investment and concerning running the process. So I have to know all that quantitatively, because otherwise nobody would build that plant. So I'm used to giving quantitative statements. I'm also used to give a complete picture. Why? Of course, if I forget something, some major influence or even some minor influence in the overall interplay between the different variables that are relevant in a chemical process, the outcome, the quantitative outcome, will be wrong. So I, as an engineer, am used to really trying to get a picture as complete as possible. Well, actually, in the beginning, I usually set up the picture with much too much detail, and then I look at the different facets of that picture and then evaluate which influences are really relevant and which are of minor importance, and possibly I leave them out then, because performing quantitative calculations for them is then too tedious, too expensive versus time and with respect to money. With the methods I have to derive the quantitative statements and to get the complete picture, I'm then able to derive at something which I call reliable intuition. As an engineer, I have to obtain some feeling how things interrelate. And based on that feeling, I'm then able to decide which assumptions in these two previous steps are acceptable and which are not, which lead to a strong effect on my outcome and which are of minor importance. In order to be able to judge that, I need a reliable intuition. For that, I really need to have numbers and things I can grasp mentally. Numbers not too big, for example, so that I can really relate them to something. And then finally, I would like to state that for this presentation of these small videos, I will use only freely available information, nothing secret. One very big data source is the database of the United Nations. They produce, for example, information on the world population, how they expect that that will change. They collect huge amounts of data on food and biomass utilization, so there's and also on land area that is available. So huge collection of data by the United Nations. Then we have, for example, the IEA, the International Energy Agency. They prepare data and derive from that the so-called World Energy Outlook, that is a projection of how world energy will develop in the future. And then there are many other smaller sources. Also some energy companies are supplying data that are easily used. And so all these things that I'm showing here in the future, they are publicly available. And that's also important, no hidden things, no secrets that I want to show. Based on that, we then derive again at this agenda, and we have now seen something about the motivation, my personal motivation, and some things I want to relate to later on in the presentations. Next video will be on balances, how to set them up and to use them. Then we want to set up the scenarios towards the future and finally arrive at some conclusions that refer to ourselves. I hope that you will join me again for the next videos. And for today, I'm finished with the first video on balances as guides towards a sustainable future. Thank you very much.